All right, so first off, we have Professor Alex Dimakis from the University of Texas at Austin, who's gonna tell us about deep generative models and inverse problems. Professor Dimakis, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Hold on a minute, let's set up here. Okay, you can see me and hear me and all looks good? Okay, so thank you very much for the kind invitation. It's a great lineup and a great program you have. So I'll be talking about deep generative models and how they can be applied for inverse problems. Most importantly, this is joint work with our great students here in UT Austin. Some have graduated already, and also some of it is a joint work with Eric Price, who's also at UT Austin. So I was expecting, you know, more of focusing on the experts, you know, based on the lineup. But maybe there are more people from a broader audience. So please do ask me questions at any point through the chat or by jumping in. So the first thing I want to define is what I call deep generative models or generators. For the purposes of this conversation, they are neural networks that are they take some input, which is random noise, or what's called a latent code or a latent vector. And I want you to think of this as a low dimensional vector, like 100 numbers, basically. You feed in 100 numbers here. These 100 numbers are multiplied by some matrix, and then there is a ReLU activation here. There's another matrix, another ReLU activation. And at the end of 5 or 6 or 8 layers, you're going to get a big vector here that then you reshape as an image. Here I'm reshaping it as a 64 by 64 pixels, and you see this particular image. And the important thing to emphasize is that this is not a real person. This is just the output of this neural network when you feed in the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to 100 as an input in this network. So mathematically, it's a function going from RK, where K is the low dimensional input, the latent space, which is 100 dimensional here, up to N, which is the number of pixels. More specifically, it's actually 64 times 64 times 3, because there's 3 channels. So there's actually 13,000 almost dimensions in the output of this thing. And it's a differentiable function almost everywhere, because it's a piecewise linear function for ReLU activations. And it is learned, these matrices, which are the weights, are learned from samples. So it's a data-driven way to learn the structure of data. And these things in the last 4 years or so have been remarkable. Like, at least I was looking at samples like this, and they were saying that these pictures you see here are not real people. They're actually generated samples from neural networks that learned the statistics of human faces, and people have trained them from many other data sets. They produce, you know, amazing results. They pass what I would call a visual Turing test that you do not know if these are real people or actual dreams of a generator. And there are many types of generators you may have heard. Some of them are called GANs, generative adversarial networks. Some others are called variational autoencoders. Some other are called score-based or diffusion-based models, and so on. It doesn't matter for this conversation how you train them. But as long as at the end of the day, you're giving me a neural network that takes a low dimensional latent and spits out a sample. But the thing that has been that I have been thinking about since essentially 2017, when I first saw these things and I said, oh, I really have to do something here because this is so exciting, is, okay, we can produce amazing fictional pictures, okay? But can we do something useful other than that? So one answer you will see is a silly answer like this one. Let's generate some fake pictures for fake social media accounts and so on. And people do that. People use GANs to create fake images of people and create fake social media. But this is not useful. And the main point of that I want to say is that beyond this use, they're actually extremely useful for countless applications. So I will argue in this talk that they are modular. And I will explain what I mean modular. Differentiable prior distributions that will learn the statistics of your data set, and your data set can be images of people or images of maps or images of MRI medical imaging or images of any or even audio or anything else you want to model or represent. And then if you have trained a generator for the data you care about, I would like to argue that it's extremely useful for countless applications. And the general umbrella term is called inverse problems. So inverse problems include things like denoising, which, you know, you observe samples with noise and you want to improve their quality. in painting, which is the problem of missing data, essentially, you're observing only partial samples and you want to complete them. Colorization of photographs is a problem that everybody understands. You see a black and white picture and you want to convert it to a color picture, like an old black and white picture converting it to color. So that's basically, you can think of it like in painting, the three color channels from the black and white observations. Compression, like super classical application, and also the whole range of problems called compressed sensing, which involves reconstructing from linear projections, and also many others, medical imaging, phase retrieval, seismic imaging, anomaly detection, and so on. So I will tell you a general framework that I think will make it clear that all these problems can be solved if you have a generator for the data you care about. So this is my outline. So this framework is called compressed sensing using generative models. We call the CSGM framework. It's based on a paper we published in 2017. And then since then, so it's an unsupervised way to solve inverse problems using pre-trained deep generators. And it also has some interesting theory that extends essentially the theory of compressive sensing for the cases of generated data. And then this theory has been developed much more significantly since this first paper. For example, Paul's work on analyzing the optimization problem, the non-convex optimization problems that appear here, has been very interesting and very influential. And then after that work, we had a follow-up paper where we said we were able to invert with slightly different conditions. And then Costis also had an even more recent paper where he was able to show that we can invert with gradient descent under the easier conditions that we had. So basically, there has been a theory of optimization problems that have been appearing building on this framework. I'm going to very briefly talk about it. And if anybody has questions, we can talk more about it. But what I want to focus on today is a new innovation that's called intermediate layer optimization that solves essentially a crucial problem that we were facing since 2017 that was blocking many real applications. So this will appear in ICML 2021, and we have here the paper and also the pre-trained models and the code that anybody is welcome to use or ask us questions. Okay, so the fun part at the end is things like how to turn people into frogs. I will show you examples like that. And also the not fun part, how bias and fairness are arising in the setting of inverse problems, not in the classical machine learning settings, of course, because many things have been said about that. So let's just jump straight through the fresh results. I'm showing you an inverse problem here. So I was giving a talk at Michigan a few months ago. This is Vijay, who was my host. I went to his website, I downloaded his picture from his website. It's 225 pixels by 225. And I removed these pixels here, right? So these pixels here are missing. And so this is an in-painting problem. So using our technique that's called the compressed sensing with CSGM technique, my students got this result. Now, a few things to notice. This image is actually 1024 by 1024. So we're doing super resolution in addition to in-painting. We are plausibly completing the missing data, right? This person has two eyes and a mouth and so on. And you might also notice that this person is actually a white person, whereas Vijay is from India, right? So there is an interesting bias issue already happening in this example. So, but the biggest problem is that even though it's a plausible good reconstruction, it's not really Vijay. You wouldn't be recognizing it from this picture. So by doing this intermediate layer idea that I'm going to talk about, by optimizing the layers one and two of the network, my students got this reconstruction. And by optimizing layers one through four, we were able to get this reconstruction. That's actually a pretty good reconstruction of Vijay. So if you got this image, you would be able to, I think, understand who the person is. So this is kind of the latest innovation that expands the range of these generators and allows us to actually get recognizable results and also essentially relax the bias that comes from the generator. Okay, so the mathematical setting is that we have a linear inverse problem where X star is the image we want to reconstruct, the pixels of Vijay's image here. But we don't get to observe them. We observe a matrix times X star. So these are the measurements here, Y. And the problem, of course, is that the number of measurements is smaller than the number of dimensions of the unknown signal. And we assume here for simplicity that the measurement matrix is known, okay? If the matrix is unknown, that's another line of complexity. And of course, there can also be noise, and the goal is to recover X star from Y. This is of course a nilpotent problem. There are many possible solutions that explain the measurements since we have M linear equations with N unknowns and M, you know, is smaller than N. So this is the whole premise of high dimensional statistics, where the number of parameters is larger than the number of samples. So the only way around this is to make an assumption, right? So the assumption is that X star, the thing we want to reconstruct, has some structure that we know. And for many years, we have been making our living by assuming essentially that X star is sparse and trying to prove things about the reconstruction under the assumption that X star is sparse. So the main thing that I'm interested in the last 2 or 3 years is removing this assumption and saying instead that X star is in the range of a pre-trained generative model that somebody gave. So we're replacing sparsity with that. So that's a general idea. Now, more generally, if you're familiar with linear inverse problems, you may observe a matrix X star plus noise. And the very general classical way to reconstruct the problem is find an X that A explains your measurements, but also makes this regularization term happy, so to speak. So this R in the classical sparsity world says that I want X to be sparse, right? So I'm penalizing you if the L1 norm of X is large, which is a proxy for the sparsity. But in a more modern data-driven world, R of X can be a neural network that looks at an image and gives you tells you how good of an image, how natural that image is. So in a very special case that we call the CSGM, the compressed sensing with generative models, we are only exploring Z's in the latent space. So we're only searching for, instead of searching over X's in the pixel space, we are only searching over generated images. So we're staying within the manifold of generated images. And we're trying to find for a generated image that explains the measurements, okay? So this can be seen as a special case of this general framework. If we think of R of X to be plus infinity, if X is not in the range of the generator, and otherwise it is uniform over all images that can be produced by the generator. So that's one easy way to think about it. And of course you can generalize this and put a soft score onto more different likelihoods of generated images. So the general idea, as I said, is sparsity is a decent model for natural images. It has given us JPEG, MPEG, MP3, and so on. But now we have these data-driven models for structure in high dimensions that are these deep generative models. And the key idea is let's replace X's K-sparse with X's in the range of a deep generative model. By the way, a recent fact by Akshay Shushrut and Eric Price is that this assumption is actually a proper generalization. So what they did is they constructed a network, a generator, that has in its range only K-sparse vectors. Okay, so and it's polynomial in size. So that means that if you're working with vectors in the range of a generator, that includes k sparse vectors as a special case. So it's a strictly more expressive structural assumption. So the key issue is how would we solve inverse problems if we have this assumption that X is in the range of some pre-trained generative model? So let's start with the simplest inverse problem, which is inverting a generator. So we have an image, like let's say this picture from my website that we call X1, and we have this pre-trained generator. Specifically, we're using here a generator called StyleGAN 2, which is a very, very powerful generator trained by NVIDIA. And they spend, I think, tens of thousands of dollars in GPU time to train it. So we're searching for a latent input so that the generated image looks as much as possible to my image X1. How would we find such a Z? Well, the way you do anything in deep learning is you basically write a loss and you do gradient descent, right? So we write the loss that is, I want a generated image minus the target image to be minimized. This is the L2 norm for simplicity. You start with a random Z, you're going to get a random face. And then you compute the gradient of this function because this network is differentiable end to end. And you do gradient descent to update Z. And you run this non-convex optimization problem that is, by the way, provably NP-hard if the network has more than 4 layers. And we get this image. So this image, this guy, you know, kind of looks like me, you could argue. It's actually an excellent high resolution picture. It's 1024 by 1024 picture. It looks very, very realistic, but it's not really me, right? And that is the core of the problem we've been facing, that the generator has its own, you know, priors about what it can produce. So that has been limiting us. But as a general method, that is the CSGM method, that let's search in the range of the generator to produce something that matches the measurements. And you know, we propose this, and independently from us, all these other people propose the same thing because it's a pretty obvious thing, you know, to propose. But there's a little bit more. How would you solve a more general problem in painting? So now you have this person, but you're missing a lot of pixels. So instead of trying to generate an image of a person with a lot of black pixels in the center, you're only going to generate a picture that agrees with the observed pixels, right? So we write this like that. So we say, I want a generated image so that after it has been measured, it agrees with my measurements. And if you run gradient descent, you get this picture, which again, doesn't perfectly match, but it's a pretty plausible in painting for the for these measurements. And this method, this is the CSGM method that works for many problems. For example, super resolution, which is deep learning. You can write the forward operator, which is a convolution of the image with a known kernel that essentially averages the pixels, right? So the way you blur an image is you put a little square and you're averaging pixels in a local neighborhood, convolving the image with a little kernel. And then we will search for a generated image so that after it has been blurred, it agrees with this blurred observations. So we get this reconstruction. And we this is the general algorithm that we proposed. And it simply says, let's do gradient descent in the latent space to satisfy the measurements. And the key idea is we can obtain gradients because we have backpropagation. There are many other methods for solving inverse problems, like what's called supervised end-to-end methods. And I would like to talk about the differences. And this relates to the theme that Jonina and Reinhardt will also talk about. And I believe that unsupervised methods that are leveraging generators that have been pre-trained have several advantages over other methods. But this is something that I think is important to think about more. So now I want to talk about this new idea that's called intermediate layer optimization. So ILO. So what is the central idea here? First of all, I will explain how ILO works as a method. We're going to look at the generator. And we're going to think of a generator as consisting of two parts. There is the first part that goes from the input vector Z up to an intermediate vector that I call H. And this first part of the generator is called G1. And then there's the second part of the generator that's called G2 that goes from H all the way to the output. That is G2 of H, that is G2 of G1 of Z. So this is a nesting of two parts of a generator. So note that I'm still using a normal generator like StyleGAN 2. I'm just looking at an intermediate layer and I'm just thinking of this generator as consisting of two parts. So the first thing we do to solve an inverse problem now is we run gradient descent to minimize over the initial input space of the error in measurements, okay? So this is just the standard CSGM approach. And after we enhance this approach, we get a Z1 star. Now, after we get Z1 star, we pass Z1 star through G1 to obtain the initialization H1. So, and then we're going to delete essentially the first part of the network completely and optimize over the intermediate layer H. And when we optimize over the intermediate layer H, we start this optimization problem with an initialization H1 that is G1 of Z1 star, okay? So this second step is again gradient descent, but it is performed in an intermediate layer. And it's important to emphasize here, and that's the part that I should take questions in case it's not clear, is we are now optimizing over vectors H that are non-realizable by previous layers of the generator. So in this sense, we are expanding the range of the generator. We are expanding the manifold of the pictures that can be created because we are manually hacking the internal layers of the brain of this generator. So this is the key part of this two-step procedure. Is this making sense, or would anybody like to ask a question? maybe I'll just give a minute here. So it's essentially a two-step optimization procedure. First, you optimize over the first latent space. And then after you find a vector Z1 star, you pass it through half the network. You start from this intermediate one and you do gradient descent in the intermediate layer. Okay. And you can keep optimizing intermediate layers one after the other. The deeper you go in this intermediate layer procedure, the more you are expanding the range of your generator. So you get a more expressive generator. So maybe I will show it with pictures too. So we start, we're trying to produce an image that matches as much as possible my target image Y, okay? So first we run CSGM, which means we're optimizing in the Z space. And after we optimize in the Z space, we get this guy, as we said. Now we start with Z1 star and we find the corresponding vector H by passing it forward. And then we do gradient descent in H, starting with that vector. And then we get this image, all right? So that's the essential trick. Now, if you look at this image looks very much like the real picture, but it's actually a generated picture. You can notice, for example, the background is slightly different and also some parts are blurry. So you can see it here in full screen. This image is not my picture. It's actually a generated image obtained by StyleGAN 2 with this intermediate procedure that I just described. So is there a question in there? Because I'm not monitoring the...
Yeah. So we just had a question from... So the question is the problem with Z1 star an optimization one or the fact that your picture is just not in the range? And how do you test this?
Great question. So I think that the problem is that it's not in the range. I don't have hard evidence, but the way I test it is, so I have no way of testing it with this picture, okay? I have no way of knowing if there is a Z that produces my face for StyleGAN 2. But I can take some actual artificial generated pictures that I know there is a Z that produces them. And then when I run CSGM for them, I essentially get back the correct image back. So I know that my inversion, my optimization process almost all the time never has a problem empirically. So this is my understanding with StyleGAN 2, assuming that you tune your learning rate correctly. And I don't know, Paul, what's your experience in this, but that's my current understanding of this.
Okay, we have another question, but and then I guess maybe I'll let you get back to the presentation. But when you say expanding the range, do you mean expanding the range of G1 in particular?
No. So okay, good. So let's understand this part. This is the key. So I really want people to understand. So there are some vectors H that can be produced by G1. Okay, G1, and that's the important thing, is a network that goes from 100 dimensions, let's say, to 200. Okay, so not every vector here is realizable by the previous layer because only it's a 100 dimensional manifold in a 200 dimensional space. So almost everything is not realizable, right? So when I start with a realizable H, I am realizable. There is a Z that produces that H. But then when I start doing gradient descent in this intermediate layer, I will no longer get H vectors that are produced by some Zs, okay? So I'm able to leave the manifold and I'll show an example of this. Let me show another picture. If you don't do this carefully, you get images like this one, okay? So this image, you can see it? So in this image is what you get if you're optimizing H, but you don't stay close to a realizable H. So you get images that are not realistic faces. So, basically the closer you stay to realizable H vectors, the more realistic you stay, but then you are more constrained by the manifold. Yeah, so, okay, so let me go on. So basically that is the main idea of intermediate layer optimization. You have to tune the hyperparameters. You tune how many layers you run it for, and how many steps you perform in each layer of this intermediate optimization. And it's a balance between getting a too expressive generator that will match the measurements well, but produce a non-realistic face, and a too narrow generator that will produce an excellent realistic face of somebody who's not your real person, like in this case. This is too restrictive. It's an excellent looking face, but it's not me, all right? So moving on to show examples of this, here we're showing now how we can use this method of ILO for inpainting. Now in inpainting, the observations we have are these images right here. So this image, sorry, I need my pen. Where is my pen? There's my pen. So this image and this image are the observations. And in this one here, for example, we're observing 1% of the pixels. So it looks like a dust of observations. And these are the ground truth images. This person is Stefano Ermoni, he's a professor at Stanford, you may know him. And this is actually a generated image. This is not a real person. So in both cases, I was actually shocked in this. I asked my students to check the code 100 times that they don't have a bug, because I couldn't believe that the reconstructions they get are so realistic from these observations, right? So the code is public, by the way. So we still hope we don't have any bug, but please do, you're more than welcome to experiment with it with your own pictures. We have a live demo too, that you can upload your own images. So overall, it's working very well for in painting. Here I'm showing you denoising. The same method can be applied, as we said, for any inverse problem, but denoising, the results are good, but they're not as exciting. This I think is pretty interesting. Here we do super resolution. So we have downsampled the images 16 times, okay? So these are very, very low resolution inputs. And then if you run CSGM essentially with a few extra improvements in a paper that's called Pulse, that got a lot of attention recently, you get this guy. This guy, if you search, is called White Obama in the social media. There was a fiasco that people uploaded this, low resolution image of Obama, and they got these generated images. Again, this looks like a pretty realistic person, but it's not matching the, Obama, and it also has this bias issue that we said. And I think also it's also very pronounced in this example here, where it produces this image, and this one here, it just doesn't look like the actor, of course. Whereas the results we get with ILO are shown in this column, and you can see that these images are arguably much better reconstructions. And here you see the ground truth. The main thing I want to say is that ILO actually reduces the power of the prior. The prior here is StyleGAN 2. And even though the prior is biased in producing, white people, because it's been trained on a celebrity data set that has, I don't remember, more than 80%, I think, white participants, and young too, and so on. ILO relaxes the power of that prior, and hence seems to reduce the bias issues. We are trying to apply this method now for magnetic resonance imaging. So I'm going to show more results on that in a minute, but we need basically a generator trained on MRI to do that. And we have trained one. But I think this is one of the very exciting applications of this area. So I have a lot of quantitative results. Overall, ILO performs very well compared to the previous techniques, especially in the low measurement regime. I can show more results offline or if people are interested. But overall, it's significantly better in all the tests we have done. And I want to show briefly the modularity aspect, okay? So I can generate an image. So where is the, okay, hold on a minute. I'm expanding this, I'll skip this part. I don't need that now, but I want to show you this part. Okay, so how to make frog people, okay? So one thing I can do is I can generate an image, and instead of having a linear measurement, like with a matrix, I can have any non-linear measurement. The forward operator can be any differentiable function. So I'm going to take an ImageNet classifier, which takes an image and tells me, gives me a bunch of logits about if the image is a cat or a dog or a frog and so on. And I'm looking at specifically the frog output of the ImageNet classifier. So I can search for Z over Z's that generate images that maximize the frogness of an image, okay? So the frogness of an image is how much frog this ImageNet classifier says there is in an image, right? So if I run ILO, I get these pictures like this one, and you can see that I have expanded the range of StyleGAN 2, because StyleGAN 2 doesn't produce frog people like this one. These are only obtained because we are searching in the intermediate layers. This is, by the way, a goldfish person. You may notice a goldfish tail up here. But the more fun part here to finish this is, how do you turn your friends into frog people, right? So we take here Stefano, which is this image here, and I write this loss here. I say, I would like to search over Z, right? so that the output generated image has two things. It has zero times the frogness of the generated image, okay, plus lambda times the distance of Stefano to the generated image. So if we just minimize this loss with gradient descent, like always, we get this picture here. This is just the projection of Stefano in the range of this generator with intermediate layer optimization. But as I increase this coefficient, the generator will produce an image that looks like Stefano on one hand because of this term in the loss, but also makes this ImageNet classifier say that it is a frog, okay? So as we increase this hyperparameter, we get one. So you see it starts adding some features that make that look like a frog, and more and more and more and so on. So it produces images that are biased towards both matching the target image, but also the classifier. The reason this is interesting is the modularity aspect of this framework, right? So if you have some other neural network that tells you how good looking you are, for example, you could say, hey, keep it a face of me, but also make me more good looking. Or you can probably think of more useful applications depending on the type of inverse problem you have. But the main aspect I want to say is the modularity, the plug and play of the little boxes. And then you just stick any loss terms you want here, and you tune hyperparameters, which is quite useful, I believe, in inverse problem settings. Now I'll show you a video of how it's searching in the latent space, first to match Stefano in the first layers, and then in the deeper layers to start producing the frog features. So you can see here that it is exploring to match the actual attributes of the target image up to here. And then at this point onwards, it starts actually introducing frog features being biased by the ImageNet classifier. So you can see here, it starts changing the attributes to make it more and more like a frog. And I think it stops around here, yes. So the non-fun part of these aspects has also, we have discussed it already, how people discovered that, it turns, you know, Asian people into white and African-American people into white and so on. And this was the example on Twitter that showed this white Obama fiasco. And again, I think that this ILO methodology produces finally images like this one, which are arguably much closer to the ground truth, as opposed to the previous methods that only optimize in the latent space. So we are expanding the range of the generator, and that is mitigating the bias issues. So I want to briefly touch, because the next two speakers are actually a great choice of talking about other methods for solving inverse problems. And the way that most people are solving inverse problems is what I call the end-to-end supervised approach, right? It's the black box approach. Let's just take a bunch of real images, let's measure them, and then let's train a neural network to go from the measurements back to the real image. So we're just literally training a black box to go from measurements back to the image. This is not what we are doing, right? We are leveraging a pre-trained generator that was only observed on faces, and we have separated essentially the learn the statistic on faces with the problem of denoising, or the problem of inpainting, or the problem. So we have separated basically the observation process from the statistics of the images you want to reconstruct, right? Whereas a denoising or an inpainting end-to-end method learns both at the same time. So it's only particular to a specific inverse problem, to a specific forward operator. So end-to-end inversion techniques have been proposed in hundreds of papers for different applications, going from MRI to seismic imaging and so on. And I believe Reinhard and Yunina may talk about these. And they just create many pairs of measurements and images using a simulator. And they train, as we said, a network to do the inversion. If you can get a good match data sense, these methods are very, very powerful. They're actually very hard to beat in their own game. But what I want to say is that these methods are actually very brittle in terms of how they perform once you change the problem they were trained on. So Reinhard has a recent paper on this. There have been other papers that pointed this out recently. And our recent paper also points this out. So here's an instant example. Here we trained a generative model on MRI images, and we trained it on brain scans, okay? So this is, for example, our reconstructions from an MRI scan. And this is state-of-the-art techniques on the Facebook MRI challenge. This is slightly better actually than our reconstruction, but they're competitive. But the moment you change the game, for example, by changing the type of measurements. So here we have taken, we have changed the type of measurements we take in the MRI by putting a different mask. The end-to-end method fails miserably here, and less miserably here, but it degrades rapidly. The other methods fail quite miserably here too. I will explain this in a second. But the Langevin dynamics using Stahlgan to prior, which we're showing in these experiments, are pretty robust to changes in measurements and here in anatomy. So what I'm showing here is an anatomy shift. We trained this on brains, but now we are reconstructing a knee. So it's quite surprising that a generator on MRI images of brains performs this well in reconstructing images of knees. So overall, the main thing I want to say is that we're pretty hopeful that unsupervised methods will be the way to go for many inverse problems because of their robustness, not because of their performance in a narrow domain. So I guess I will skip the bias issues. And the main thing, the main takeaways is we use guided unsupervised methods to create synthetic data that agrees with the observations we have. This is a general idea. We are searching the latent space to match the measurements, and we are expanding the range of our generators as needed, depending on the number of measurements. That's this intermediate layer optimization allows us to adapt how deep we go, depending on how many measurements we have. Older generators like DC GAN that we were using in 2017 were very sensitive to any variation, for example, in cropping, in rotations of the face, in color, in the color range, and so on. But we think that today with intermediate layer optimization and the modern generators that like StyleGAN 2, we're actually able to solve these problems. And of course, it's very, we need to be very careful when we're extrapolating the bias in the training set. When we're doing, let's say, any application, for example, in MRI imaging, and we're trying to diagnose people for any disease and so on. So there's also a lot of very interesting theory questions that are open, expanding the sample complexity bounds from the compressed sensing sparsity regime to generative models has been the basic theoretical open area. And I think there's a lot more questions to look into here. So I will stop here and take any questions if there are any. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Professor Dimakis. So we do have a couple of questions. We have maybe about 3 minutes for questions and then we have the next speaker. So the first question from Murali is that for the faces that were problematic with pulse, I mean, how did the results, you know, between ILO and pulse compare using an MSE metric? And is this just a perceptual advance or is it also a quantitative advance in the MSE?
Great question. So the loss we are optimizing actually is a mixture of mean squared error and LPIPS, a perceptual distance. So we actually get a smaller mean squared error too. So expanding the range actually allows us to get smaller mean squared error, but the actual loss we end up using is a mixture of the two. So, and that was, that actually matters a lot too. But yes, we get smaller MSC too.
All right, so we have a question from Philippe. So can this be used as a compression scheme?
Good question. So the latent vectors here are continuous, or you know, they're very high, they're doubles, they're very high precision. So we haven't looked at it so much for this case, but if you use a discrete, there are these VQ VAEs, which have discrete latent spaces, and they are actually extreme compressors. So if you use a VQ VA, you certainly can compress, and I think it is very good, and I believe that all compression methods will be using deep learning techniques in the future. I don't think that we're quite there right now, but I don't know if they will be generator based necessarily or some end-to-end technique, but certainly it can be used, but you'll have to also deal with quantization is the short answer, unless you use a VQ VA.
All right, and then I think we have time for one more question. So this is that, so your work suggests that the latent space, you know, of these generators does not have sufficient dimensions to capture the real world faces. Would it be possible to increase the input dimension of the latent space gradually until you get, you know, better performance?
You can, but you have to train these generators with different latent dimensions. And that's a huge pain. And that has been our problem in the past, is we didn't want to train multiple generators depending on how many measurements you have in your inverse problem. We want to separate the, learn the statistics of human faces with, oh, I want to denoise with this much noise, okay? And this has been, the center of our idea is separate these two things. Learn the nature of human faces or learn the nature of MRI scans, that's one business, and then invert them if you have this many measurements as a separate business. So ILO allows you to adaptively pretend your generator is more expressive or less expressive depending on the number of measurements you get. Otherwise, you have to train multiple generators. We were thinking about doing that, but it's just very hard to do in practice. So, but yes, it could be done, but I prefer optimizing intermediate layers rather than training multiple generators.
All right, that's all the time we have for questions. Thank you again, Professor Dimakis, for the wonderful presentation.
Thank you very much.